السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. جزاكم الله خير. To everyone who's come today for our end of course dinner. Alhamdulillah, it's been a really great series, 5 weeks in preparation for seeking knowledge for our course that we've just done, Student of Knowledge Survival Guide. Alhamdulillah, we went through some fundamental manners and etiquette that a student of knowledge should have, and some lessons that are very important and key for a student of knowledge in preparation for our September program. Alhamdulillah, we have a lot lined up for you guys in September. On the screen is just one example of a program that we have lined up for you guys, inshallah. So inshallah, the evening will go as follows. We'll begin with a recitation of the Quran by our Ustadh Yahya. And then he'll do a small lecture, inshallah. And then at about 10 past 9, there'll be a small presentation of what we have planned for September. And then we'll have Maghrib, Salah, and after Maghrib, we'll have the food, inshallah. I'll pass over to the Ustadh now for his recitation, inshallah.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم كذلك نقص عليك من أنباء ما قد سبق وقد آتيناك من لدنا ذكرا من أعرض عنه فإنه يحمل يوم القيامة وزرا خالدين فيه وساء لهم يوم القيامة حملا يوم ينفخ في الصور ونحشر المجرمين يومئذ زرقا يتخافتون بينهم إن لبثتم إلا عشرا نحن أعلم بما يقولون طريقة إن لبثتم إلا يوما ويسألونك عن الجبال فقل ينسفها ربي نسفا فيذرها قاعا صفصفا لا ترى فيها عوجا ولا أمتا يومئذ يتبعون الداعي لا عوج له وخشعت الأصوات للرحمن وخشعت الأصوات للرحمن فلا تسمع إلا همسا يومئذ لا تنفع الشفاعة إلا من أذن له الرحمن ورضي له قولا يعلم ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم ولا يحيطون به علما وعنت الوجوه للحي القيوم وقد خاب من حمل ظلما ومن يعمل من الصالحات وهو مؤمن فلا يخاف ظلما ولا هرما هضما وكذلك أنزلناه قرآنا عربيا وصرفنا فيه من الوعيد لعلهم يتقون أن يحدث لهم ذكرا فتعالى الله الملك الحق ولا تعجل بالقرآن من قبل أن يقضى إليك وحيه وقل رب زدني علما.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ولي الصالحين، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله، الداعي إلى صراط مستقيم، صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن سار على نهجه واقتفى أثره يوم الدين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
After praising Allah جل في علاه, and I think I've turned off the mic. What's happened? I fixed it. After praising Allah Jalla fi ula and sending salutation upon our Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, we proceed. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says in the Quran,
قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَٰلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِّمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ.
Say, O Muhammad alayhi salatu salam, bi fadlillah, with the bounties of Allah, the blessings of Allah, the favors of Allah, wa rahmatihi and His mercy. فَبِذَٰلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا, with that they shall rejoice. هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ, that is better than everything else that they accumulate and gather. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling us His blessings, His favors, His bounties, they are what we need to rejoice and celebrate. And no doubt, when the believer, he finishes one act of worship, and that act of worship leads into another act of worship, that is something to be celebrated. We just celebrated a few days ago Eid al-Adha, right? After we had worshipped Allah, we strived in the first 10 days of the Hijjah, the greatest days of the year, Allah Azza wa Jalla legislated that we have Eid al-Adha and Ayyam al-Tashriq to celebrate that ibadah, inshallah, that we have done in those days. After Ramadan, that month of worshipping Allah Azza wa Jalla, Allah legislated that we have Eid al-Fitr to celebrate that ibadah that we have done. In Islam, we celebrate achievements, we don't celebrate mere dates or times. Rather, we celebrate achievements. And that's why Ibn Rajab, rahimahullah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he says, لَيْسَ الْعِيدُ لِمَنْ لَبِسَ الْجَدِيدُ إِنَّمَا الْعِيدُ لِمَنْ اسْتَعَدَّ الْيَوْمِ الْوَعِيدُ. He says that Eid is not for the one who wears new garments, just for the sake of it, he makes himself look very nice, etc. But Eid is for the one who prepares for the promised day, Yawm al-Qiyamah. Meaning, he's achieved something. That is the one who really celebrates Eid, right? Because he's achieving, inshallah, he's celebrating, inshallah, that Allah accepted his deeds. So he's rejoicing, hoping and having good assumptions and good thoughts that inshallah Allah accepted it. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. And just like that, today we are celebrating coming to the end of this course, right? And inshallah we are celebrating that we have learned something that will draw us closer to our Lord, that will bring us closer to Allah Azza wa Jal, in worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal, in order to be successful in this world hereafter. If one has done that, that is something to be celebrated. That is something to rejoice over. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they were those when they would complete an act of worship, they would constantly be asking Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to accept it from them. Asking Allah constantly to accept it from them. Because true success, it is not just completing the act of worship, it is Allah Azza wa Jalla accepting it from you. That is what matters. That you are sincere to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala in this act of worship, and that because of your sincerity, Allah accepts it. and it weighs heavy on your scales yawm al-qiyamah. And the best voluntary deed that you can do is to seek knowledge. A lot of the ulama, they believe that seeking knowledge, sacred knowledge, it is the best voluntary deed. It's better than all the other voluntary deeds that you can think of. So doing the best voluntary deed, which is seeking knowledge, and continuing on that path, it is something that we should all aim to do. Because it's the most noble path. It's the most noble path that you can ever take. Why? Because it's the path that leads to Jannah. Simple. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said in the hadith, the famous hadith, مَنْ سَلَكَ طَرِيقًا يَلْتَمِسُ فِيهِ عِلْمًا سَأَهَلَ اللَّهُ لَهُ بِهِ طَرِيقًا إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever treads a path, seeking in that path knowledge, Allah Azza wa Jal makes easy for him the path to paradise. Through that path. That path will make the path to paradise easy for you. And notice that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said طَرِيقًا, indefinite, a path. He didn't say the path. It is not one path. There are numerous paths to seeking knowledge. But all those paths, whatever path is easy for you, take it, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was saying, in seeking knowledge, stick to it, and that will make the path of Jannah easier for you. This is the path that you attain the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah Azza wa Jal is pleased with the one who seeks knowledge. The angels are also pleased with the one who seeks knowledge. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala praises the one who seeks knowledge in the heavens. And the angels make dua for him. And the rest of the creation. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ حَتَّى الْحُوتَ فِي الْبَحَرِ وَالنَّمْلَةَ فِي جُحْرِهَا لَا يُصَلُّونَ عَلَىٰ طَالِبِ الْعِلْمِ. That Allah, He performs salah upon the student knowledge. Salah from Allah, it's Allah praising you in the heavens. And the angels performing salah upon you, it means that they're seeking forgiveness for you, making dua for you. And even the fish in the sea, and the ants in their holes, are performing salah upon the student knowledge. What does that mean? That they are seeking forgiveness for him, making dua for you. Imagine. By you being here, attending these sessions, benefiting, you are attaining that great virtue. Great ni'mah. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah wa tabarak wa ta'ala, when he would be engaged in seeking knowledge, he would leave all the other voluntary deeds. Why? Because he believed that seeking knowledge is more rewarding, more virtuous than all the other voluntary deeds. Khalas. He would just dedicate his time to seeking knowledge and he would leave the others at that time. Showing how great it is. Why? Because in Islam we have a principle. The principle it is that the deeds that extend to others that don't only benefit you but benefit others as well, they are more virtuous than the deeds that only benefit you. So now, seeking knowledge does not only benefit you, it benefits others because you're going to benefit others with that knowledge that you've attained. You're going to teach others, you're going to share your knowledge with others, and so on, right? So because of that, it extends to others. And that's why it is more virtuous. And that's why the ulama, when they explain the hadith that I mentioned earlier on, that the animals, they make dua for the student knowledge and the scholar and so on. The ulama, they say the reason why the animals are even making dua for him is because the student of knowledge and the person who possesses knowledge, he is the one who looks after the rights of the animals because of the knowledge that he possesses. And so they're not oppressed. So due to that, even the animals are making dua for him. But what we need to remember, you have kiram, it is that when we start an act of worship, especially a voluntary act of worship, we need to stick to it, especially seeking knowledge. You know, seeking knowledge is what protects our hearts from decaying and dying. Seeking knowledge is like the fish in the sea. When the fish is taken up in the sea, what happens? It dies slowly, right? Slowly dies. That's the same as the believer. The believer, when he's taken out of knowledge, right, his heart slowly dies. It's so gradual that you don't even realize. That's why Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has legislated that every single week that we attend a sermon that's obligatory. Friday khutbah. Why? To keep your heart alive. That's your reminder of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. That's for the one who doesn't attend any circle of knowledge. Khalas, just to keep his heart alive, he's obliged to go to the Jum'ah. But the believer, he's the one who goes further than that. He's conscious of his heart. He does whatever it takes to protect his heart. Because the heart, it is the king of the limbs. The Prophet ﷺ said in the famous hadith, أَلَا وَأَنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةً إِذَا صَلُحَتْ صَلُحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ أَلَا وَهِيَ الْقَلْبُ. He said that verily in the body there's a piece of flesh. If it's sound, the rest of the body will be sound. If it's corrupted, the rest of the body will be corrupted. Verily, it is the heart. The heart is extremely important. And that's why Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Quran, أَفَلَمْ يَسِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فتكون لهم قلوب يعقلون بها أو آذان يسمعون بها فإنها لا تعمى الأبصار ولكن تعمى القلوب التي في الصدور. Allah says, do they not travel the earth and have hearts that they comprehend with and ears that they hear with? And verily doesn't blind their sight, but the hearts that are in their chest, they are blinded. It is the hearts that we comprehend with and that we really see with, right? So protecting that heart, it is what allows you to have that insight, that basira that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala He grants to His believing slaves who protect their hearts and their sight and their limbs from doing that which is haram. Allah grants them basira, insight. It is said that one of the ulama of the Salaf, his name was Muhammad ibn Sirin rahmatullahi alayhi. Muhammad ibn Sirin, he was known for his great insight and being able to interpret dreams very well, and also he had extremely strong firasa, right? So they said that Muhammad ibn Sirin, the reason why Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala blessed him like that, it is because he used to protect his sight, his eyes from haram, looking at haram. And due to that, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala protected his heart. To the extent that Muhammad ibn Sirin, rahmatullahi alayhi, he once had a dream. And in that dream, there was a woman in that dream who was not covered, and she's not his mahram, she wasn't covered properly. So he lowered his gaze in his dream. Are you hold account of what you see in your dream? Of course you're not, right? But that's how cautious and careful he was, that even in his dreams he would lower his gaze. So the ulama, they say because he protected his sight, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala protected the insight of his heart. Right? So when you protect your limbs from haram, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala preserves your heart. It will keep your heart sound, healthy, alive. But it's based on you protecting your limbs from doing that which angers Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. In the famous hadith, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, hadith Qudsi, that Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu narrates, he said, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said that Allah Azza wa Jalla says, مَنْ عَادَ لِي وَلِيًّا فَقَدْ آذَنْتُهُ بِالْحَرْبِ وما تقرب إلي عبدي بشيء أحب إلي مما افترضته عليه ولا يزال عبدي يتقرب إلي بالنوافل حتى أحبه. That the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said that Allah says, whoever shows enmity to an ally of mine, whoever shows enmity to an ally of Allah, Allah says, I declare war against him. And then Allah says, my slave does not draw closer to me, but something more beloved to me than that which I have made obligatory upon him. So the obligatory deeds are the most beloved deeds to Allah. And then Allah says, my slave doesn't continuously draw closer to me with the voluntary deeds until I love him. So the more voluntary deeds you do, the more Allah Azza wa Jalla loves you. So what happens if Allah loves you? The hadith goes on to say that Allah says that if I love him, I'll be his sight that he sees with, his hearing that he hears with, his hand that he strikes with, and his feet that he walks with. What does that mean? That Allah Azza wa Jal will protect you from doing that which angers him, and he will facilitate for you to do that which pleases him. And then he goes on to say وَإِذَا سَأَلَنِي لَأُعْطِيَنَّهِ If he asks me, I shall grant him whatever he asks for. وَإِذَا اسْتَعَاذَ بِي لَأُعِيذَنَّهِ And if he seeks refuge in me, I will grant him refuge. So this hadith teaches us that when we observe our obligatory deeds, and then we follow a type of voluntary deeds, even if it's one, the ulama they say, that we are consistent in one voluntary deed, we attain the love of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, and that is the formula to protecting yourself from disobeying Allah. That is the formula to protect yourself from disobeying Allah Azza wa Jalla, because Allah will be your sight, your hearing, your hands, your feet, meaning Allah will protect you from doing that which is haram. So observing the obligatory deeds and following it up with voluntary deeds, even if it's one that you continuously do for the rest of your life, Allah Azza wa Jalla will protect you with it, protect your limbs, and protect you from doing that with angers of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Talabul ilm, let seeking knowledge be that voluntary deed that you hold on to, that you're continuous in for the rest of your life, and with that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala protect you from doing that which angers him and displeases him, and you'll be amongst the allies of Allah Azza wa Jal, bi'idhnillahi Azza wa Jal. That is the message that I wanted to share with us all, inshaAllah ta'ala. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make us from those who hear the speech and follow the best of it. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to forgive our sins. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to have mercy upon us. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to grant us beneficial knowledge. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to guide us and to increase us in guidance and to guide others through us. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make us his righteous slaves. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to have mercy upon us and our parents. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla, just like he gathered us here this evening, that he gathers us in Jannah Firdaws al-A'la, innahu li dhalika al-qadir alayh. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Barakallahu.